Good morning and very good afternoon on behalf of Department of Medical Education and Indira Gandhi Medical College Shimla. Just continuing with our series of webinar, today we are going to discuss what are the issues, concerns for the safety of healthcare workers who are working with COVID-19 patients. And today's my presentation is dedicated to our colleagues who have already lost their lives during this pandemic, and also dedicated to the most valuable resources during this pandemic. Those are our healthcare worker workforce. So let's have this look on Sunday's story. We have these 31 nurses and 5 doctors, then additional 31 followed after later on. And this is one study which was published in Science in March beginning, which said that before the onset of transmission, when these restrictions were put into place, to around there were 55% of documented infections were not reported. So that's why there is a reason that there are number of issues why this is going to be there in such a large number. And my presentation is also dedicated to my teachers, because of whom I am in front of you. And this is one of the cartoon which has been prepared by one of our colleague, who says blind men and COVID-19. So there are number of stories like BCG vaccine, no vaccine or drug, plasma therapy, Ayurvedic treatment, isolation, quarantine, yoga, meditation, hydroxychloroquine, which we are going to discuss later on in few slides, and antibody test, which we have just landed in India and world over. So meaning thereby that we are not having anything concrete so far in this epidemic. So why should we healthcare workers and we should spend time about this? This is one publication which was published in February to begin with by CDC. So healthcare persons are at heightened risk of acquiring COVID-19 infection, but we have limited information how this transmission occurs in the healthcare settings. So they had a group of 121 healthcare professionals, and around 43 became symptomatic when they were tested for COVID. So this is just a beginning in the month of February. So there are certain issues which are important in the care of these patients, which we are going to discuss. And what are the implications of this? So actually, it has been now seen and discussed world over that unprotected and prolonged patient contact, as well as certain exposures like some aerosol generating procedure, AGPs as they are called in shortly, they probably are associated with infection in healthcare professionals. So we are going to discuss them later on. And another issue that we are not immune to this virus right now. More than 100 doctors, probably this list is beyond 200. And still we are counting on this one. So what are the issues? How this is transmitted? So it is basically transmitted by this coronavirus. It's transmitted by the droplets. We know by this time. And even coughing and normal talking, even speaking loudly as I'm saying right now, can bring around 3000 droplets up to 2 meters and respiration up to 1 meter. And as I discussed in the beginning that this issue regarding the generation of aerosol when we are doing some artificial procedures like cardiopulmonary resuscitation, bronchoscopy, surgery and autopsy. So these are all going to lead to risk of transmission of this virus. How this virus is transmitted? So these are the area we discussed last time also. So when the droplets are beyond 5 micrometer, they tend to remain trapped in the upper respiratory tract here. And those less than 5, they probably go into the bronchi and alveoli in the lungs. So these are the two areas of concern. And there's another concern with the super spreaders, because they are going to say which are going to produce more of aerosols particles as compared to others. So that therefore it is again important to remember with them. And these particles are again in the range of microns. and they are carried by the air currents and dispersed by diffusion and air turbulence. So there is issue between inhaled droplet versus aerosol particles. And as we discussed, these droplets are deposited in the upper region, and these aerosol particles are carried upward either by and may be cleared by the mucociliary escalator to be expelled or swallowed. And finally, when we look into those aerosolite particles, they penetrate to the depths of the lungs, where they may be deposited in the alveoli and give to the manifestation of this disease. So this one of the scientific report which has been published around on January 2019, this showed that there are other unknown physiological factors also which could affect the probability of respiratory infectious disease, because it's a general one. So one need to take care of all these concerns when we are dealing with. So what are the issues we need to take care to prevent infection in healthcare professionals? One is CDC recommends use of alcohol-based hand sanitizers. It should contain 60% ethanol or 70% isopropanol. And this should take around 20 seconds, and then surgical hand scrub. But remember, hand washing with soap and water is the first one, and rest of them are the secondary one. Another important issue to take care is one should try to avoid contact with eyes, nose and mouth. And if some, we need to practice cough hygiene. And if respiratory symptoms appear, then one should put on a surgical mask after washing our, putting it after washing our hands. And if we are working in a setting, so try to maintain a distance of 1 meter from those symptomatic patients. So we had been discussing what are sanitizers and disinfectants in this during pandemic. So let's briefly discuss over next 2-3 minutes. Sanitizers actually reduce the number of germs on a surface, whereas disinfect kill most of them. That's one of the difference between them. And they actually, their definition is based on how long time they are going to take to work, which is labeled in literature as dwell time. So when you use any sanitizer, it is going to work immediately, whereas the chemical in that disinfectant is going to take up to 10 minutes of kill germs. So that's why there is a concern when we are dealing with those biomedical waste issues. So what is going to have another issue? Because we are discussing that alcohol and alcohol. So those which use vodka, do you think, are you going to protect yourself? No. Why? We'll discuss later on. And before that, let's learn why this alcohol is the main, why this alcohol is the main ingredient in most hand sanitizers. Because it has been shown that alcohol has got some properties. It can kill both certain species of bacteria as well as viruses. And why does it kill them? Because it has got property, because there are certain bacteria in which there are proteins on their cell wall which gets denatured. This is one of the issue. And those viruses which are having envelope on their cell wall, they are also easily killed by this alcohol. So why 60% alcohol is good and 100% is better? No. So issue here is that there are a number of studies which have shown that 60% alcohol is good. Reason is that if you use 100% alcohol, it is not effective because some amount of water is needed for the disinfection effect by the alcohol. So if you use 100%, it's going to dry your hands also, and you will have more of dryness. So that's the reason that you use 60% alcohol is recommended. We are using number of hand sanitizers, and you must have seen number of program on the TV. Are they good idea? No, because we don't know whether they are going to contain how much concentration of alcohol, which is very important. So one need to remember that. And the same is true for the vodka, because vodka is 40%. So it is not effective at all. Do they expire? Yes. There is a shelf life of approximately 5 years. But the one issue that we are using in this pandemic, probably there is no issue concern of expiry date of these. But when we keep them for a long time, they are not used. So what happens, this we know this alcohol gets evaporated, that may decrease their efficiency. So that's another issue. So we have a certain safe work practices, what we are going to do. What are those? for this SARS coronavirus, there are certain issues when we are working in the healthcare setting. There are certain things that has been recommended, like tissues, no touch trash cans, hand soap, alcohol based handles as we discussed, disinfectants and disposable towels along with the sufficient amount of PPEs. So how to practice, how we are going to take care of this? These are the ideal situations when we are dealing with these patients. So at least if we want to place, the ideal recommendation is place these patients in isolation rooms with negative pressure, and that should have at least 12 air changes per hour along with a dedicated bathroom and if possible one empty room. Alternative is, because we are not going to have them most of the places, so we use room with a natural ventilation with airflow of 160 liter, and if you have suspected cases, they should be put in the single room or in the same ward. So far we have discussed that droplets are the primary issue of transmission of this disease, how the healthcare workers are going to take care. So first and foremost come the mask. So how this mask came, they were being used in the industry, and it came with use in the industry, and then later on it was taken care of. So primarily we discussed also last around 10 days back. So it is important because the surgeons were, they were using just to prevent the sneezing or coughing during the surgery. And it has got three layers, but we discussed innermost layer is the most important. That contains absorbent material, and outer layer is of a particular material which is going to repel the liquid. The issue with the surgical mask is the life is around 6 hours, maximum around the 8 hours, depending on the issue, place where we are working, the environmental humidity, temperature and volume of the air breathe. So we have two more types which we discussed last time also, both valve as well as non-valve type, that is N95 and N95, which we discussed that it is basically because of the their penetration of the oil to them, they have been labeled as N95 and N99, which is going to efficacy of 99%. So let's briefly look what is the efficacy of these masks which we are using. So it is said that 95 is around 99% protection, surgical mask around 75%, and a cloth mask, if they are minimum of 2 layers, then 67% of protection. So when you are using an N respirator, what are you going to look for? Being discussed by the NIOSH. So actually, because now this is a time of scarcity, so we don't get those many things, but even then one should try to look into those. What is the filter designation, whether this is certified by that or not? So that's one important, and this is the way how we need to put on these breathing masks during this spread of COVID. After washing our hands with soap and water for 20 seconds or before putting them or after removing them. So this is the way to put on. So there are certain available masks. Let's discuss their comparison. How many of them are suitable for COVID-19? So this FFP2 and FFP3, these are UCO NHS based guidelines. This N95 is used by CDC and US. So except FFP1, rest of all, they are to be acceptable. And see, this we are not going to do. When we are putting on those surgical masks, these are number of shots which I have taken. This is how they should not be dangled around in the neck because they are for the single use. So one should not be putting, and if you are putting it, then they need to be used in a given way. And these are different. I saw on this Sunday in Shimla. So you can see these are not a respirator actually. We see people are using them. This again, these are not with the respirator, and they are costing around between 350 to 500 rupees. So I don't know how much is their efficacy because these are not respirator, they are just. And another issue is the environmental degradation. So this is the, when we start using them, they are going to be, so we need to take care and discuss and educate the public also. Another issue, as we are seeing, we discuss also the, can it be used for extended use? Yes, with certain precautions. So one need to look into that when we are using it for extended period, it should, mask must maintain its fit and filtration function, and what sterilizing method we are using, that should be harmless to the end user, and the mask should maintain its respiratory integrity. And most important is it is used to be by the same wearer. And if you feel or come across that it is soiled or damaged, then it needs to be discarded. And those for ICU settings or in the isolation ward, they are not going to use it for the extended time. It is only for the single shift. So these are the method. One of most important is this one is we are giving 4 baths to all our colleagues. So they are going to put it as a day one, day two, day three, and day four. And then after putting it in a drying in air in a paper bag, they are taken there to be used in the day one, like shown I like this. And this H2O2 peroxidation in 48 ppm is if you got a specifically designed chamber, then another method of sterilization of these masks. And these masks need to be exposed to around 4 hours. And remember, people are asking, there are a number of questions. So we are not going to use clean these masks with soap and warm water or alcohol or bleach or to expose them to UV radiation or isopropanol or microwaving. These are not recommended. These are to be used if you are using somebody in general public using homemade cloth mask. So what are the other PPEs in addition to the mask which healthcare persons are recommended to be used when they are working in these settings? Let's have a look on this. This is the primary area because this is the most important areas. One need to be careful. We need to careful how we are going to prevent this transmission by use of mask. And because these three mucous membrane, nasal, eye, and there are reports which one can get contaminated. So it is recommended that we are using those for protection of eye. We are using goggles or face shield. And for skin, we are using either gown or overalls and along with the gloves. We'll discuss them later on. So how to stratify the utilization of PPEs when we are working in these settings? If it is a high risk where we are going to produce any aerosols like in ICU or like intubation or something in emergency, then it is recommended that full complement of PPEs, which we are going to discuss briefly. And if there is moderate risk like N95, moderate risk of contact with the patient or secretions, then N95 and these gloves are recommended. And if there is no possibility of contact, but there are chances of exposure to the infected patient or low or secretion which is labeled as low risk, then triple layer mask and gloves are to be used. And if there is hardly any exposure, then no protection is needed. So this is a risk stratification so far as per the CDC and Government of India. So this is a face shield. This is the goggle. If you are not having face shield, then goggle has to put on like this. And these are the long sleeves gowns. And one must ensure that when we are using these gowns, there is a space here or a specially made so that it is tagged here. So this is again important to looking when we are using those gowns. These are very small issues, but they are of very important. This is not going to be folded when we are working. So people did one study, so why this came off for 7 and in compared to modified PPs for aerosol generating procedure, because it was seen that there were some countries and places where they were using this gowns, yellow gowns, like which you are seeing on this right hand side. So after repeated uses, its efficiency has gone down as was assessed in one of the simulation exercise. So that's why we came for use of single gown use. So that's again important to remember. So these are the guidelines of ministry which we are aware, and these are available freely. So one need to go into that, and this is a very clear document which show us what is to be done and what we are going to work in. So my concern is that if we are working in isolation rooms, or if patient has been quartered in isolation rooms, the one need to use this is moderate risk area, N95 mask and gloves. And remember, there is no aerosol generating activity. And if we are like in ICU critical care, then full complement of all those 7-1. In emergency, so because the risk is moderate one, so one need to be use N95 and gloves. So these are for the our healthcare workers which are working with those different categories. And there is another set of recommendation from the European Union, which also recommend that we for all these protections, which is same as per the Government of India recommendation. So one need to look into these both the documents. These are WHO approved. Why something about gloves? So remember, nitrile gloves are preferred over the latex gloves because they are resistant to chemicals. And we are going to use non-powder gloves plus shoe covers. Shoe cover should be made of impermeable fabric so far, and head covers are also recommended. If somebody is using coveralls, then head covers are not recommended. Because there are a number of studies which I am going to share one or two later on. This donning of PPE is very important. So do head washing, then put on these inner gloves, long sleeve gown, followed by tying up, then mask or respirator, depending on the risk stratification we discussed earlier. And one need to, when you are using this respirator, then one need to look into the leakage of air. Goggles and face shield, like this. This is a way to put it on, and then the outer glove. So this is complete, and we can compare on both sides. And here it is a preferred PPE, which should be, but sometime because we are looking in this pandemic, there is shortage is going on. So there is alternative. If we are not having, if we are using face shield, not N95 or respirator, high respirator, then for acceptable one, face mask can also be used. So this is a procedure which we already discussed details. So, but the important issue is that one should be careful of protocol in an institution for decontamination of coveralls and N95 respirator. And remember, there are a number of queries people are putting in different groups. The decontamination of PPs and then to reuse it is not recommended at all, whether you are working in any setting. And these are the last resort method, and the people have not studied what is their efficacy. Segregation is that they should be deposited separately when somebody has taken them off in clearly level red bins with red double bags, and should be into 11% hydrogen peroxide solution. And goggle, they can be reused by after using either 70% alcohol or in bacillal solution. If there is a shortage, then they can be used. So this is one Cochrane very important review. Why I put in here that it shows that there are three issues. One is that as we teach, then do the simulation and hands-on training. So as we move from one, first to second to third, the use, donning and doffing also improves in the sense. So what should be I doing when I put on and suspecting handling those COVID-19 suspected patients? This was published recently in the last week of April. And this is the data from one of the hospital from the Wuhan in the early days. And we can see these are the hot zones. Like ICU contamination was around 32%. Obstetric isolation ward around 28%, and isolation ward. The reason here from this center was that there are a number of people who visit the antenatal mothers, and that's the reason that they had been able to look into the isolation. Even the hand sanitizers, because this is being used for everyone, so one need to look into that those hand dispenser and hand sanitizers are also decontaminated. They were able to look into around when they were looking into 15% of the gloves. This is a printer, desktop, doorknobs, most important area, telephone in ICU, and this is around the rate in the medical equipment area. So when going to enter, at least take care of some things. So ideally, if there is, then there should be a changing room in the hospital when we want to check into, and we should check into, and we should not wear those watches, rings or bracelets. We should not carry bag, computer, even a wallet to work, not even our this belt, okay? And leave work shoes in the car or outside the home when we are going to back, and avoid putting your mobile phone on the bed, whether at home or then on call room. Please be careful because this is one of the area it should be decontamination. And if somebody is working in ICU setting, then it is recommended that these clothes should be washed separately, and if somebody is putting on glasses आईडी बैज पेन कीज मोबाइल फोन्स दे नीड टू बी डिसइनफेक्टेड बिफोर स्टार्टिंग वर्क एंड बिफोर गोइंग होम. सो दीज आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड इफ इट इज इफ इट परमिट्स देन वन शुड टेक शावर वन रीच इज द होम. सो टेक केयर ऑफ दिस लाइक डिस्पोजेबल इफ यू कैन हैव दिस वन थर्मोमीटर समथिंग एंड यूज 70% इथाइल अल्कोहल फॉर डिसइनफेक्शन एंड क्लीन एंड इन्फेक्ट ऑल दो सर्फेसिज विच कम इन कॉन्टैक्ट विद द पेशेंट्स एंड यूज पोर्टेबल एक्सरे मशीन्स और बेड साइड चेस्ट अल्ट्रासाउंड विच आर डेडिकेटेड फॉर दीज एरियाज ओनली. So we have seen, so then because we are doing a number of procedures, because it is seen that around 80% of these patients, they will need just oxygen supplementation. Around 3 to 4% will need intensive care for ARDS. So how to prevent, because these are the areas. So because these patients are going to be on oxygen supplementation for a prolonged time. So it is important to practice good hand hygiene and PPEs. And if there is insufficient spacing because of the overcrowding or rooms without negative pressure, then one need to care for sufficient ventilation and one need to look into the exhaled air dispersion time which is given there. So if you use oxygen by nasal cannula, the maximum exhaled dispersion is to be shown to by 100 centimeter. And remember, when we are using with this NIV with helmet with tight air cushion, so it is negligible air dispersion. So this is because these are the issues which we are going to come across when we start seeing these patients. So when we are working with this, one need to take care of these. Because a few of these patients may be on nebulization, so one need to be careful because if you do the nebulization, then drugs with this jet nebulizer, they will leak from the sideways. And this distance also increases with the increasing lung injury. So there are a few of the data which has been shown. So if it is dispersible distance is 45 centimeter in the normal lung settings, and if there is mild lung injury, then it increases to 54 centimeters. And if you in a patient there is a severe lung injury, then it increases to 80 centimeters. So this is the distance how this exhaled air can travel such a distance in these patients when we are using these procedures. So what are the precautions we can take care for this aerosol generating procedure, because very important to begin with. It has been shown that what has been seen, one of important is that's one of ultraviolet fluorescence study simulation. We showed that when we don off those PPEs and doffing procedure, so that is actually this shown to be one of the very dangerous area for infection by the healthcare workers. Another area which we are dealing is daily, because now we have to take more and more of nasopharyngeal swabs. So one need to put in the PPEs like this. This is the way how one need to take care of this area. Then this is the way how we are going to take it. And finally, how it is going to be put into that bag and then specimen bag and transmitted to the lab in minus 4 degrees temperature. So there are certain precautions. So at least wear appropriate PPE, and we should have a latex-free purple nitrile gloves. We discussed earlier why they are better. Maintain proper infection control, and those area where we are going to contact, collect these samples, the visitor entry should be restricted, and we should have all guidelines for the disposal of the paper to prevent the. Now these are few procedures which I am going to discuss, which are going to we care when we are using the working with these patients in ICU setting. One is high flow nasal catheter oxygen. So what is recommended is that we put on a surgical mask of the patient to prevent the aerosol into the environment. And another important is when we, even we are doing to do bag and mask, even when we are going to intubate or before that. So we are going to use this virus filter connection is recommended for this simple respirator, which is very important to prevent the contamination of the ear surfaces. And this is a mask with exhalation vent. And here you can see this is a closed mask. So this is basically a recommended one. So that because along with the viral filtration system, and we are going to use these closed single lab. These are not recommended with exhalation vent, because otherwise we are going to have contamination of the atmosphere in the work area. If you are using those face, this is a double tubing ventilation, so it is recommended that in those critically ill patients, when we are using NIV, so we put on those face masks, and along with in the inspiratory limb put a bacterial filter, and for the expiratory limb put a viral filter to minimize the contamination of the surfaces as well as to the healthcare workers. Just to continue with the, because these are certain procedures, so in this patient, if you are using negative pressure suction, then it needs to be covered with, mouth needs to be covered with mask, very important. And this is a negative pressure, so if we got facilities, so one should go for the use negative pressure suction tubes, so that we have a minimal of aerosol dissemination. Same in the procedure when we are doing tracheostomy or intubation in those areas. So viral filters are recommended along with the bronchoscopy jack. So this is a non-invasive mask through this T-joint, which is inserted into bronchoscope when somebody is going to collect those samples. And in this figure, we can see that this is a circuit, which breathing circuit along with extension tube with intubation tube, so that if you want to collect sputum, how safely we can collect it without the contamination and risk of the healthcare workers. So these are the sequence donning when we are going to do for procedures like this in these patients when you are going to take them for intubations. So in those patients, because a few of them, which I said around 3 to 5% may need mechanical support, so when we are doing to do tracheal intubation, so person should be trained in how to put on full PPE. He should be available, because this is the area, otherwise so highest level of PPE should be available, that's around 80 GSM. And if there are some shortage, then minimum requirement is protection to the eyes, one fit tested respirator, at least N95, and fluid resistant gowns and gloves. When we are doing intubation, so if we need to pre-oxygenate, then at least give them 100% oxygen for 5 minutes. But remember here, avoid bag and mask ventilation. If necessary, then if one need to use HEPA filter or HFNO, but somebody should be experienced here. So what is recommended ideally is video laryngoscopy in the initial attempt, and intubation has to be done those which are experienced one, it is not for the lay people. And finally, after intubation, there are certain issues which we need to take care of. So after we have done those patients which are in the ICU care, let's talk about our colleagues who are working in labor room. So these are the recommendation for them. So baby and mother has to be separated with a distance of around 2 meter. One curtain need to be put on. For resuscitation, we are recommending those American Academy of Pediatrics NRP guidelines, which are endorsed by Indian Academy of Pediatrics. So what are recommended here is, one is this incubator with head for providing heating source. And just to take care of airborne precautions, so one need to put on a respirator or N95. Along with the goggles, face shield, double gloves and gown, meaning thereby that our colleague in the obstetric department has to put on doff on all 7 recommended one when they are doing. And for baby and mother, because those our colleague pediatrician who are working for the resuscitation, they should be standing around 2 meter or 6 at a distance of 2 meter or 6 feet from the mother with a barrier, a curtain in between, and that room need to be warm one. So these are the procedure how we are going to do in the labor room. So ideally it is recommended that we should have a negative pressure room, preferred one, and this mother should be provided a mask, triple layer surgical mask, and if feasible we should be able to communicate with our, she should be able to communicate with her partner. And because now there are no issue, if there we are working with aerosolized procedure, something, the patient may get sick, so one need to be ready in that areas. Delayed cord clamping is recommended in some guidelines. Some say that immediately you shift the baby, And remember, there is no there are no recommendations for skin to skin contact. Important issues to take care, there has to be minimal number of providers, and these are all we need to take care. And if ideally available for my colleagues, then there has to be this transport incubator with this equipment, and we should have one additional provider which is trained in resuscitation outside the room. So an active room is preferred, but if it's not there, then one need to work in those setting which is there, and one additional person is also recommended. So sometimes patient may land up in emergency situation. So what are the precautions we need to take care? So ideally it is recommended that we should avoid emergency intubation, but sometimes we may need to go for emergency. So avoid bag and mask ventilation. Ensure that patient is adequately sedated, which we are going to discuss in ICU care setting on coming Thursday. What are the sedative which we can use safely in these patients? And remember, it is recommended to minimize the number of healthcare workers and all equipment, medication in the room, and we are not going to use the crash trolley because we are not going to rush, we are not going to spread the infections. So these are few of improvisation which people have worked, and these images has been taken from the Google. So people have even recommended that you can have this intubation box like to prevent the aerosol generation for, and this is a closed suction. It has been improvised one, and this is how we are going to give MDI through the ventilation technique, because we are not going to nebulize as we discussed, because they have got the highest risk of generation of aerosols. So do not, when we are using conventional oxygen therapy, it is recommended that we are not going to use humidifiers, and the patient is recommended to put on a surgical mask. And when we are using nasal cannulas, do cover them with the surgical mask. And this is the distancing which we are going to practice to prevent the dissemination. So this is just only one article, one study which is published on 16th April. These people, this group of professionals, they have tried it using povidone-iodine nasal spray and mouthwash during the pandemic, and they are come across with the observation that this do reduce cross infection, protect healthcare workers, but remember that this is just a draft version, and this article has not been fully peer reviewed, so one cannot take, but in the coming time we may have these recommendation also if it proves to be important one. So why our colleagues are at risk for contraction of the disease? Because there are certain sometime gaps in the PP training and their effectiveness. We'll show a few of the photographs you later on, and we don't know how much are PP available in which place and how we are going to work, because as we are working in the area where there is a scarce of PP, so, and infection control is again an area of mix of science and make do necessity, so it's important. So people are just finding out ways how to take care of this time of scarcity. Why we are at high risk of, because this is a mild but very prolonged disease, and sometimes this person may be to begin with absolutely asymptomatic or minimal symptomatic, but they can infect persons, especially the healthcare workers. Incubation period can extend beyond 2 weeks. There are reinfection, as we are seeing number of cases from reports from Korea and China. And remember, it's very difficult to distinguish COVID-19 from the other respiratory viral infections. And only around 50% are going to have fever on presentation. And as we know by this time, the sensitivity of NP swab is around 70%. And sometimes there are not facilities, or because of large number of samples, the diagnosis is delayed. These are all risk factors which probably put our healthcare workers for higher risk of infection. And we are also changing, like these policies for use of PPs are also changing. So there is a confusion in our healthcare worker. This has come from America. So because that is now, based on that, they are going to take care how much are available, how going to use them. So what are the best practices for reuse? There are no practices except for the N95. So evidence right now is even there that it's important in the training and circumstances which we are working is very important. So we should be knowing what are the PPEs available with us, what is their efficacy, and how we are going to use them for maximizing their use. So this I had taken from Twitter because there were some messages were going on in California, because this California hospital that said out that there are no PPEs, how we are going to work on. So people said okay, that but remember, then we are at the receiving end. People, even our colleagues in those hospital has worked even without PPEs because they could not see a dying patient whether there were PPEs were available or not. But that is going to increase the risk to the physicians. This is yesterday, very disturbing news, because now as healthcare workers, we have patients, this pandemic is emerging, the data is coming, we don't know what is to be done, there is no vaccine, no drugs, and then general public is also after us. And then this is the latest one, there is shortage of PPEs, and what we are going to see, this is yesterday, India Today, they did one story. So everybody is manufacturing these PPEs and one is not sure of the quality of them. That's another area of concern which has just recently emerged, because everybody's. So one need to be take care when you are using those PPEs, kindly to look into their certification also. That's again very important. And then one area which is being actively or hotly being discussed, should healthcare worker take prophylaxis? So first I'd like to discuss, these are the guidelines by ICMR, which was released on the 2nd of March. ICMR's technical task force discuss or recommended rather that asymptomatic healthcare workers which are involved in the care of suspected or confirmed cases, they should take. And the second category was asymptomatic household contact of laboratory confirmed cases. And I'll show you later on that what has happened. There are newspaper reports. This is the dosing schedule. And there are certain category. This prophylaxis is not recommended in children under 15 years or those which are got evidence of retinopathy or hypersensitivity to hydroxychloroquine or for aminocolloid. These are the category which are absolutely not indicated. And along with, there is a long list of monitoring. So one need to look into the hematological parameters, blood glucose because of hypochloric potential of HCQ, ECG. And remember, these HCQ or these drugs are not going to be administered along with antiarrhythmic, antidepressant, antipsychotic, antihistaminics, terecycline, ondansetron, azithromycin, and maxifloxacin. Now, azithromycin is being used as one of the co-drug with hydroxychloroquine in certain patients and certain settings. And recommended is to do ECG daily, and it should not be used with lopinavir or ritonavir or remdesivir. There are no recommendations right now. And as usual, one need to maintain pharmacovigilance and mental disturbances in the mental status. So this came in Indian Express. So what is happening here is that to use malaria drug or not to, because before it is being recommended for almost all even contacts in the Dharavi, the government of Maharashtra, certain areas in Madhya Pradesh. So these are probably the disturbing one, because just one study which came from France National Drug Safety Agency said that they released a data of 43 patients. And what I would like to say, they said that one need to be very careful when we are using, and especially in those with the underlying cardiovascular disease. There are a number of ongoing trials. This is a long list. And these trials are going on in different countries, starting from Thailand, UK, Germany, China, Korea, and nothing has been come up so far. One more interesting study which came, that people are using either chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine in COVID-19 with or without diabetes. And this systemic review, what it said, there is no conclusive evidence so far that this chloroquine or it should be researched as a prophylactic in endemic area. So everybody so far is recommending that they need to be recommended as prophylactic drug. One need to do into the trials. So let's have more on. This is a clinical trial by in US going on. And again, the ICMR recently came up last month only. These initially they came up with the guidelines, and but now they are saying that they are coming up for trials. So this is a statement by Mr. Gangadhar, which we know is appearing daily on all televisions. So what they said, that it is going to be a trial so far, and it is not recommended for everyone. Even then, some states are going to beyond those guidelines. And there are two very interesting reports which has been published only last 2 days. This is from our colleagues, but they have rightly pointed out certain issues, that though the preclinical results are promising, but there is dearth of evidence to support the efficacy of HCQ in preventing COVID-19. So one need to be careful. At the same time, the safety issues are also very important. One more communication, we said that in areas of pandemic, we can resort to these, but if somebody is using this, one cannot use a blanket recommendation because there is no evidence right now. If we still we are using HCQ, a clear informed choice need to be offered to every contact, explaining the scarcity of evidence for its efficacy in the potential risk. So one need to look into, these are very important areas. ICMR also has just recently launched a study on side effects. They said around 10% are going to have. So this is again the same newspaper report, that few countries are going to give HCQ for everyone. And this is one of our colleague, he has got a hospital where the strength is around 4,500, and 3 days back, his staff had around 18 nurses. They tested positive for COVID, and this gentleman said that he prevented those complications by using hydroxychloroquine in these healthcare workers along with the homeopathy. And he said that there are no complications in any of my patients. I don't know, we don't have so much any data, but this is just a statement which he has used them. So again, one more issue, that we are, this policy for PP use are also changing. That's also putting confusion in our mind. So one need to be take care of, and we need to update our information on daily to daily basis. So it was in one of the study where there was one positive infant, and people have studied the atmosphere. They said that the aerosol deposition of protective apparel or floor surface and subsequent resuspension in potential transmission pathway, one of has been recommended, documented as for the transmission of coronavirus. So sometimes what happens when we are not even we are aware, but we don't doff in a given way, so we can contaminate. So one need to be very careful. And in this study, a researcher tested the face shield, gown, and N95 mask. And what they came up, that though the DNA was not detected on PPE, but it was found on the bed rails, the bed table, which was around 3 meters away from the bed in this case. So one need to be careful when we are working in this area. So this is again one more MMR weekly report, which was published on 15th of April. So healthcare workers, around 9,000 healthcare workers were reported cases, COVID-19 cases has been reported, with a median age of 42 years, 73% of being female, probably that is according to our nursing colleagues. So one need to take care when we are working. So what are the implications of this communication? So it is important to ensure the health and safety of both healthcare workers at work as well as in the community. And one more recent area which is coming, because our community is at long many stress, so one need to look into. So there are number of studies which are coming even of mental illness in our colleagues. So what is recommended is limit checking in with the news and social media either once or twice a day. Otherwise, you will get such a large dose of corona that one may feel uneasy. So that is going to increase the stress and anxiety. And when we are off from the duty, take a break away, decompress, stop and some take deep breath. And if you can go out, move into some natural out around your homes, and it will probably help your mood and help your sleep also. Eat as healthy as you can and keep yourself hydrated. Avoid unhelpful coping strategies such as excessive caffeine, alcohol, and nicotine in these areas at this time. And please do keep on communicating with family, friends, and colleagues, and discuss over difficult cases. Consider formal debriefs later, if you feel worried, and we can all support each other. Prioritize sleep. So remember, if somebody is having tense or anxiety, then it makes harder to sleep. So not try to worry what is going to happen. So one can use those meditation apps which are going to help us for the sleep also. And we all know that exercise is good for physical and mental health. If we can get time, then try to take out at least 15 to 20 minutes daily for exercise. And we have, everybody has got some liking. So try to take out some time for those activity which we were earlier enjoying outside our work. These could be very important and important way to reduce the stress. So my dear friends, work as a team and be there for each other, support each and everyone. And look, please do look after yourself and each other and take care. So these are again more issues in this cross-section study of around 215 plus healthcare workers. In China, it was reported that a considerable proportion of healthcare workers have symptoms of depression, anxiety, insomnia, distress, including healthcare workers. And these are the depression in around 50%, anxiety in 44%, insomnia followed by distress. So one need to look into. So just to summarize before I finish what we have discussed so far, we all know that health workers are very susceptible and high risk of infection. Irrespective of the age or place of work, whether it is OPD setting or you are working in ICU or those where aerosol are generated or not generated, because we are not immune to this disease. And we know there are more and more factors are emerging as we are, more and more evidence is coming in this disease. ICMR recommends HCQ prophylaxis in asymptomatic healthcare workers, but so far we do not have a time tested RCTs. So one need to be careful when we are using and do take care of all those factors which we already discussed, what we need to take before somebody jump on to take hydroxychloroquine. And let me share even those people, because my few colleagues, we are getting discussing and phone calls, because somebody is dealing in OPD. One of the patient turns out to be positive later on, and they are starting hydroxychloroquine. I don't know what is the basis, because there are no so far guidelines or recommendation so far. Risk stratification, we discussed already that in which area. So try to optimize use of PPEs. And there is no substitute for hand hygiene and disinfection of the contact surfaces. One need to be taken care for. This has got very strong recommendation. And it is mandatory to understand how to don and doff a PPEs, because number of study that when we are doffing, then we can contaminate the environment or even ourselves. Extended and reuse of N95 coverall, it is allowed, but remember it is not preferred. So it is recommended that why time we have scarcity, as we are going to get more and more PPEs, then we should be going back to those previous recommendations. So far N95, so far the preferred method is air drying with mask rotation. Coverall, if we have shortage or scarcity in your place, then they need to be disinfected with 11% hydrogen peroxide. Goggles and face shield, they need to be disinfected with 0.5% sodium hypochlorite before we are going to use them again. So avoidance of all aerosol generating procedure, absolutely not advised at all. And the preferred way of oxygen by a non-mask or with the helmet interface. So you've seen that people, as we are using in pediatric practice, those head walks, they are being recommended for oxygen supplementation. Physical barriers, teleconsultation, and absolute policy for the rotation of healthcare professional, which is preferred to prevent, minimize the chances of infection. Social distancing in the hospital setting and try to existing resources is the need of hour, as we show. And it's very important that you and all my colleagues are the country's most available resources right now, even in the world. And it should be our endeavor, safety of our administrators, those who are looking to, the safety should be the top priority of our healthcare workers. Please thank you very much for your patient listening. And if there are some questions, I'll be more than happy to respond to them. Thank you very much.
So should facial hair be removed when using PPE?
Yes, it is recommended, because we discussed in the last presentation that there are certain styles and hair which are, if we with them, if we are using our N95, then there is a leakage of hair, and probably especially in those areas when we are working in ICU, that can jeopardize all efforts for minimizing the infections. So, thank you very much. We'll see you tomorrow and the presentation. Thank you.